Good morning and welcome to the 11th meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2022. This morning we will take evidence at stage one on the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill. I would like to welcome to the meeting John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, Professor Jason Leach, National Clinical Director, Greg Walker, Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Bill Team Leader, Nicola Guild, Solicitor, Laura McGlynn, apologies, Head of Health Protection and Screening, and Simon Stockwell, Head of Family Law Unit. Thank you all for your attendance this morning. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any remarks before we move to questions?
Kabir, thank you for the opportunity to give evidence on the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill. I'd like to thank the many individuals and organisations who have submitted views to the Stage 1 scrutiny from the committee's call for evidence. Last week, the Parliament voted to extend key provisions of the Scottish and UK Coronavirus Acts to September 2022. This bill is about what should happen thereafter and proposes to carry forward around 30 important temporary measures. In line with the Government's commitment to expire or suspend temporary provisions that are no longer necessary, and reporting on them every 2 months, I can confirm that over 45 temporary measures previously enacted have now expired. Kabir, the measures in the bill fall into three broad categories: powers to counter future public health threats, the embedding of practical public service reforms that have demonstrated their value irrespective of the public health position, and extended to temporary measures to manage the impact of COVID specifically on the Scottish justice system. Provisions in the first two of these three categories are within the committee's scrutiny remit, and I have followed stakeholder evidence with interest. It has, of course, been put to ministers that it would have been better to have split the bill, and there's a good reason why the government was minded to progress with one single bill. For the most part, measures in the bill across all categories exist in temporary legislation now confirmed to expire in September. They all update and equip the statute book in sensible ways, as part of learning lessons from the pandemic. They were all consulted on together as a coherent package in a full 12-week public consultation, which took place between August and November last year. And the measures in the bill collectively support the government's COVID recovery strategy and recent updated COVID strategic framework. In the particular case of public health protection proposals, it has been put to the government that these future powers are not needed now that Scotland is transitioning from baseline COVID requirements in law to guidance. I disagree. This brings into sharper focus the important distinction between having appropriate powers to hand to respond to future public health threats, which I consider to be in the public interest, and the difference of using them. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has taken a close interest in this bill and in its Stage 1 report, which was published on Tuesday. I will, of course, consider the detail of its recommendations closely, but I'm happy to signal, as I did when I appeared before it to give evidence, that I will look to work constructively with the committee on issues like the made affirmative procedure, and I'm happy to consider where constructive improvements can be made to the proposals the government has put forward. And I look forward to the committee's questions.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. And I'll turn to questions. If I may begin by asking the first question, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to outline which provisions have been included in the bill that were not contained in the temporary emergency legislation, and why have they been included in this legislation?
The government's looked carefully at all of the temporary measures that were put in place, and of course some of those measures were of a particular time limit and some have expired. The government has operated on the principle that we do not want to keep in place temporary measures for any longer than is required. So there are a range of temporary provisions that were put in place for the pandemic, which we judge are no longer necessary to be taken forward as part of the permanence legislation that we're putting forward. We have identified in the legislation, the proposed legislation, a number of provisions which have arisen out of our experience in the pandemic, particularly in the administration of public services, which we judge to be of practical benefit to the public and therefore in the public interest. And we have advanced proposals of that nature. And lastly, The legislation proposes to take particular steps to ensure that we are in a position to manage for a longer period the implications of the disruption caused to the justice system by the pandemic, and as a consequence we have a range of temporary justice provisions which are there purely and simply to ensure that we can support the recovery of the justice system after the huge amount of disruption that was caused by the pandemic.
First Minister, the committee had submissions from Dr Andrew Tickle and Professor Alison Britton, both from Glasgow Caledonian University, and they concluded that the main provision in part one of the bill are generally in keeping with the law already applying in England and in Wales. But there was one concern regarding the power to modify and amend the enactment, which I think is known as the Henry VIII power. Can I ask how the public health powers in the bill compare to the equivalent powers in England and Wales, and also why the inclusion of the Henry VIII clause was thought necessary?
The provisions are broadly comparable to the provisions that are available in England and Wales, and these provisions have been in place, I think if my memory serves me right, for the best part of a decade or more than a decade. And essentially this gets to the nub of the bill, which is the necessity of ensuring that the legislative framework that we have in place is appropriate to deal with the emergence of a major national public health issue of the type of a pandemic. Now, if we look at the legislation that has been considered by Parliament in this respect in the past, we have the two coronavirus acts, where it is fair to say, taken through Parliament at great speed. There was significant parliamentary cooperation to enable that to be the case. But of course, the level of scrutiny that was available for those provisions at that time was very limited indeed. So what essentially we are doing in this bill is taking a calm period to consider with full parliamentary scrutiny the type of measures that could be put into place should we face a further pandemic, and to enable us to ensure that we have the necessary statutory force in place to provide for that. Obviously, with sufficient parliamentary scrutiny about the government taking any steps within the framework of the legislation. So essentially, the point you make to me, convening the points were made by the legal academics, is that it's important that we have a structure of legislation in place to enable us to handle a future pandemic, but that we consider that in slow time to enable us to ensure that we have the right arrangements in place. And as I indicated earlier in my answer, those provisions are broadly comparable to the provisions that are available in England and Wales.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. Can I just ask, there is a 2008 Act, and it's in Section 94 regarding international travel restrictions, where we do have the Henry VIII clause. Has that ever been used?
I would have to defer to my officials to give me further guidance on whether that has been used, or we can write to you, convener, to clarify whether those provisions have been used. But unless my officials can add detail at this stage, I would propose to write to you on that question.
Thank you. I'm not sure if anybody would like to come in. Maybe just raise your hand because I can't see the screen. It's okay. That'd be great if you could write to me. Thank you very much. If I could just ask, why are the current procedural rules allowing for emergency bills to be progressed through the Parliament thought to be inadequate in these circumstances?
I think, again, this is an issue which I think is at the heart of the discussion around this bill. And it's a question of whether we think it's appropriate to put in place legislative change at very fast pace when the when a pandemic scenario arises. And that was what Parliament had to do on two occasions in the spring of 2020. The legislation was handled in a very swift timescale. In a matter of days, very complex legislation was put forward. And what the government has reflected on as a lesson to learn from the pandemic is, and this is a point that I think has also been made to the committee by legal academics, there is a well expressed view from the World Health Organization that countries should have in place appropriate measures and mechanisms to enable them to respond swiftly and appropriately to a pandemic. And therefore, the opportunity is there for us to consider in slower time what that range of powers could look like and could be enacted should we face that situation. So essentially, the nub of the consideration of the principle of this bill, from my perspective, particularly around about the early parts of the bill, are about ensuring that we have a legislative framework in place that enables us to think in advance about what might be the type of legislative changes we may need to make and how we can make those. And that is essentially what the bill proposes to do.
Thank you. If I could just move on to proportionate measures. Can the Cabinet Secretary explain the meaning of proportionate response and who makes those decisions and what are the challenges of doing so?
This is a theme that has been the subject of extensive discussion with the committee during the course of the pandemic and has been very much at the heart of the government's decision-making around the handling of the pandemic, and indeed has been very much central to the decision-making around the Four Harms framework and the strategic framework. The question of proportionality is fundamental because it is a legal test of whether or not any measures the government puts in place are appropriate in a certain set of circumstances. In terms of who makes those decisions, it will be ministers that make those decisions, and ministers must be satisfied that on the basis of the evidence available to them, there is a proportionate case for applying any restrictions. We have wrestled with this question on countless occasions in the course of the last 2 years and have come to the conclusions about when we judge the measures to be proportionate and when we have withdrawn measures because we didn't believe they were proportionate at that particular time. So ultimately, decisions are made by ministers. As with all decisions of ministers, these are justiciable. So we have had two legal challenges to the provisions that we have had in place. Obviously, at the heart of those questions, which the courts have wrestled with, have been the question of proportionality. So proportionality is not a tabulated concept. It is a concept based on the availability of evidence to enable ministers to take rational decisions that could be defended within the courts if necessary.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. And my last question is, do you believe that a wider review should be undertaken to ensure the 2008 Act remains fit for purpose?
I would contend, Convener, that's precisely what we have done, because I think what the 2008 Act does is it provides for public health incidents of a local nature and character. I don't think the 2008 Act could be described as an act that provides for the arrangements that need to be put in place for a national pandemic. Indeed, I think that point is made by that distinction has been made in the evidence or the comments that have been made available to the committee by the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities, who generally welcome the provisions in this bill because they recognise that while the public health provisions might deal, the Public Health Act provisions of 2008 might deal with a localised issue or outbreak, but where you have the type of national pandemic that we have faced, the 2008 Act is not sufficient and doesn't have sufficient scope and reach of powers to enable that to be the case. So I think the steps the government is taking at this stage are designed to address exactly the point that you raise with me, Convener, but of course we remain open to considering whether or not there are any further changes that need to be made, and we will consider that point as the bill progresses through its further stages of parliamentary scrutiny before its final enactment.
Thank you, thank you, Deputy First Minister. I'll move on to members now. Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Deputy First Minister, and I hope you are feeling a bit better. I want to ask some questions around the exercise of ministerial powers, but before I do that, seeing as you referenced earlier in your comments the issue of public consultation, it is fair to say that the government, when they ran their own consultation on this, found a wide degree of public concern and opposition to what is being proposed. The committee ran its own survey with the public with a call for views. We received just short of 4,000 responses from the public, of which 90% were in opposition to the bill, with people expressing concerns about the impact on personal liberty and the lack of parliamentary scrutiny over what's proposed. I can't remember in two decades a piece of legislation in this Parliament attracting that level of public concern. Can you?
I suspect there have been other pieces of legislation that have attracted public concern, yes. I suspect also the degree of public concern may have had something to do with the way in which some members of Parliament characterised the legislation, and I'm sure Mr Fraser knows the point I'm making in that remark. So I think what's important is that members of Parliament concentrate in their deliberations on the substance of the issue. And the substance of the issue for me is, do we have the right legislative framework in place to deal with the possibility of a pandemic? Clearly, we didn't have in March 2020, because we had to rush through two pieces of legislation in a matter of days to provide the legislative force to handle the pandemic. So clearly our statute book was not sufficient or not appropriate in March 2020 to deal with the circumstances that we faced. So what the government is now doing is learning a lesson from that experience and putting in place legislation which we consider to be proportionate and appropriate for those circumstances, only to be used in those circumstances in terms of the public health provisions, and for there to be appropriate and effective parliamentary scrutiny of the exercise of those functions by the government. And that's the justification for the bill, and why I think, obviously, in that wider appreciation of it would be clearly understood by members of the public.
Thank you for that response. So this issue of the level of parliamentary scrutiny and ministerial accountability goes to the heart of our scrutiny of the bill. So can I follow up, firstly, the line of questioning from the convener around the use of Henry VIII powers that are contained in this bill? And Professor Britton and Dr Tickell, in their evidence to this committee, said that this was a highly problematic element that had not been adequately explained or justified by the Scottish Government, that the lack of comment in the policy memorandum on this was remarkable, and that this aspect of the proposals required clear justification and anxious scrutiny. So can I ask you, why do you think it's appropriate for ministers to have these sweeping Henry VIII powers when we do have a clear alternative route, which is the use of emergency legislation, which, as you have already accepted, was used to put through the coronavirus legislation very quickly when it was required 2 years ago?
I think the difficulty with the, well, I think it depends which way we look at these questions. Do we look at the experience of the pandemic and think there are no lessons to be learned, and that there is, that we should be quite happy to put through significant elements of primary legislation in a matter of days? On other occasions, members of Parliament would rail against significant changes in primary legislation in a matter of days. And I think generally, in my experience in Parliament, that would be viewed not to be a desirable approach to take. So now, nobody foresaw the pandemic coming, although we had enough awareness that there was the likelihood of some form of pandemic coming. But it didn't prompt us to review our statute book. We've had the pandemic, we're still going through it. Believe you me, some of us are still going through it. And we are now trying to adapt the statute book to learn the lessons from that, so that we can put in place proportionate powers that can be scrutinised by Parliament in a normal legislative process, which is what we're going through just now. And Parliament can decide if it wishes to change its statute book to enable these provisions. So that's the the type of thinking that has gone into this legislation to make sure that we're not having to rush significant primary legislation through Parliament in a matter of days. We take stock, we learn the lessons from the pandemic, and we put in place powers with sufficient parliamentary scrutiny that enable us to act accordingly when a situation arises.
Okay, thank you. We're trying to pursue parliamentary scrutiny now. Professor Britton and Dr. Tickell said there was no explanation or justification of the provision for Henry VIII powers, and the policy memorandum provided no justification for it. So, can you tell us, in the absence of a policy memorandum explanation, why these Henry VIII powers are required?
Well, the power has been included to address potential situations where regulations are needed to respond to a public health threat that might conflict with existing legislation. So that's the justification for this. However, you know, as with all regulations made under the legislation that was put in place, it could only be used where it was necessary to respond to a threat posed through a significant risk to public health by the pandemic. So there are very significant regulatory constraints and limits in place around what the government would be able to do. But fundamentally, there would have to be a significant risk to public health to justify the use of any of these powers. So that's the rationale for why those powers are in place. To have that, essentially, that trigger mechanism of the threat to public health, and then the possibility that there may be a conflict with existing legislation that needs to be resolved.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move on a little bit and ask you about the made affirmative procedure. You'll know that the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has commented on this, and in evidence to us, Professor de Londres said that the made affirmative procedure is inherently problematic and should only be employed in exceptional circumstances. And she suggested in her evidence that if regulations were made to under Part 1, under the made affirmative procedure, a ministerial statement of the reasons for using that procedure explaining the alleged urgency should be provided. So would you accept that as a proposal for a way forward?
I think there's a lot in this area that we need to look at further. I welcome the report from the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. I think I had a very thoughtful discussion with the committee when I appeared there a few weeks ago. The committee, I think quite pragmatically, was looking at the understanding of the challenge for the government that the made affirmative procedure generally takes about 40 days. The made affirmative procedure is obviously it can be utilised with greater urgency, subject to parliamentary scrutiny at a later stage, or parliamentary consent at a later stage. So, between those, and the committee was exploring, is there some other approach we could take, which might be a halfway house or a partway house within all of that? And I'm very happy to explore that. I think the point that Mr Fraser made to me, I didn't quite catch the academic's name that Mr Fraser raised with me, but
DeLondres.
I think the Professor DeLondres, yeah. Thank you. Professor DeLondres' suggestion, I think, is again another pragmatic suggestion. Mr Fraser will probably know that some suggestions, a suggestion was made to me in oral questions last week by Dr. Gilhani around about some of this area. So I think there is scope for us to explore satisfying legitimate parliamentary concern to be persuaded about the merits of a particular action being taken by the production of, for example, as Professor DeLondres suggests, a statement of urgency to justify actions. So I think there is, I'm very open to how we can properly address this point. I do want to the statute book to be equipped with powers that enable us to act swiftly. But in acting swiftly, we have to act appropriately. And if there are other ways that we can strengthen the provisions of the bill to address those issues, then I'm very open to doing so.
Okay, thank you. And just one follow-up on this issue of made affirmative procedure. It has been suggested that the bill could be strengthened in terms of effective parliamentary scrutiny by requiring, for example, a duty on Scottish ministers to regularly appear before a relevant parliamentary committee, provision for creating a bespoke parliamentary committee in charge of scrutinising the emergency response, or a duty on ministers to provide to Parliament a draft instrument in advance of the government laying an SSI. Now, these are in effect practices the government has already followed, but would you be open to these being put in legislation?
I'm very open to considering these points. The government, the government's policy intention here, I hope, is crystal clear. It is to enable us to be able to take the necessary action should we face a pandemic threat of the type that we have faced over the last 2 years, and to be able to act swiftly and with urgency in that respect. I think it is, my reflection is that although we had a great deal of parliamentary cooperation, for which I'm very grateful to members of all parties, in the formulation of the legislation last spring, we did make a lot of primary legislation changes in a very short space in time, and generally Parliament doesn't think that's a good thing to be doing. Parliament generally wants to take time and care, as we are doing now, to consider what should be the contents of primary legislation. And some of the suggestions that Mr Fraser makes to me are entirely practical and pragmatic suggestions which can strengthen the approach in the bill. The government has no desire to be able to exercise powers in any unwarranted or unnecessary fashion. But we do want to be able to act where we have to act because of the threat to public health. And I'm certainly very happy to explore some of these questions further, which, if they take the form of points made in the Stage 1 Committee report, then I will, of course, reflect on those.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Can we move on to Alex Rowley, please?
Good morning. Best wishes. Could I ask, overall, how do the public health powers in this bill compare to the equivalent powers in England and Wales?
I think in my answer to the convener, they're broadly comparable. The provisions in England and Wales have been in place, as I said, I think in my answer to the convener, for in excess of 10 years. They have enabled a situation to be, situations of this type were obviously envisaged in the legislation that was considered by the United Kingdom Parliament, and the United Kingdom government has been able to operate under many of those provisions, although has obviously supplemented them in terms of the emergency legislation that itself has brought forward.
In terms of the evidence that we've taken so far, I mean, I would say that there is general support through the evidence that we've taken for much of the measures and proposals in this bill. In fact, I think to oppose many of these would be to do so for the sake of it rather than, because it does make sense, I get that. But one area that is clearly causing difficulties and causing problems is this Henry VIII clause, as it's called. And as I understand it, what it says is, basically, it's a statutory power given by the legislator to the executive to alter or repeal primary legislation without reference to ordinary parliamentary processes of scrutiny and amendment required for bills. Whilst powers of this kind have been used by the UK government to adapt the statute book to the UK's departure from the European Union, Henry VIII's powers are rightly controversial as they infringe upon the separation of powers, give legislative functions to the executive, and can be imposed with modest opportunities for parliamentary scrutiny, particularly in circumstances when they're used on an emergency basis. So you can see that there is genuine and sincere concern. Now, along with your partners, the Greens, you have a majority in this parliament, so there's no doubt you can ram this through regardless. So my question would be, given that there are genuine and serious concerns, particularly about this part of the bill, for those of us who certainly believe that most of this bill actually makes sense, are you willing to sit down with other parties and actually have a discussion and look again at the genuine concerns that are being expressed?
I would take from my responses to the points that Mr. Fraser has just put to me that I am willing to discuss with members of Parliament of all shades of opinion how we can address any issues that are causing concern. I think I rehearsed with Mr. Fraser the issues in relation to what might be put on the record in relation to the justification for use of any of these powers in advance of them being used. So that that may well, that I hope is interpreted as a welcome and positive step in that respect. In the wider point that Mr. Rowley raises with me about these particular powers, I think the point I would make is that the exercise of these powers could only happen in relation to a specific and significant risk to public health. So it can't happen any day of the week. It can only happen where there is a significant risk to public health. So that's sort of trigger point number one. There has to be a justifiable case. Secondly, if ministers were to utilise these powers, they would have to come to Parliament to exercise those powers, either through the affirmative process, whereby Parliament itself would be able to judge whether this was required or not, or through the made affirmative process, whereby Parliament gives its consent once the government has taken these actions, but it's obviously conditional on the government taking those steps and Parliament giving its consent. So there are a number of safeguards in the exercise of any of these responsibilities, should that be the case. So I hope that provides some reassurance to Mr. Rowley, but I would make the point that I reiterate what I said to Mr. Rowley at the start of my answer, that I am very happy to engage with other parties. I'll obviously consider, as I've said already, I'll consider and engage with the recommendations that have been made by the Delegated Powers Committee. I wouldn't want to preempt what the COVID-19 committee as a lead committee will consider, but obviously I'll be very happy to engage with the committee on its report and any recommendations it could make in its stage one report.
Thank you. I certainly look forward to having a further discussion with the Deputy First Minister on specifically these Henry VIII powers. The point is made in the evidence that we've heard also that the Coronavirus Act 2020, which is part of this bill, on effect levels up public health in Scotland to make it comparable with those public health control acts of England and Wales, Westminster. But they point out that wide-ranging powers sit within the English and Welsh regulations under the Public Health Controlled Disease Act 1984, as amended by the Health and Social Care Act of 2008. So the question then is, should there be a wider review undertaking of the Scottish Act of 2008, and does it remain fit for purpose?
I think the question here is one that I think the government has. Well, the government has worked to address. I think it's a matter for Parliament to consider this. That the government has worked to address this in relation to the contents of the bill, where essentially a number of the provisions in the early part of the bill are amendments to the 2008 Act. So it's about using the foundation of the 2008 Act as a basis of trying to address the wider issues that arise out of the pandemic. And I think this point was, and I think I made this point earlier in my response to the convener, I think this point was made really very well by the representative of COSLA, who submitted material to the committee and maybe gave evidence. That was that COSLA recognised that the 2008 Act works when you've got a problem in a locality, where you've got an outbreak of an infectious disease in a locality, and you have to take particular measures. Director, Mr. Rowley will be very familiar with these arrangements from his leadership of Fife Council. But the Director of Public Health has statutory roles and responsibilities to act. But the point COSLA were making, and which is why they indicated they were generally supportive of this legislation, is that when it comes to a national pandemic, the 2008 Act just doesn't get there. And you know, the 2008 Act had been fine, then we probably wouldn't have had to make so many of the changes that we made back in 2020. So I think there's a, I would contend that what the government is doing is amending the 2008 Act to make it appropriate for the challenges that we face just now. But obviously I'm open to areas where members of Parliament believe that there is perhaps further change that we have to make.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. John Mason, please.
Thank you very much, Convener. To move on to some of the other specifics in the bill, if I can. As you've just been saying, Deputy First Minister, a lot of the amendments are linked to the 2008 Act, and a couple of these are in 86B and Section 86C, where the first talks about directly imposing restrictions or requirements, and the second about indirectly imposing restrictions or requirements. And I just wondered, I'm toiling a little bit myself to understand the difference, and I just wondered if you could explain why there are these differences between these two parts.
The difference essentially is about, and this is, I suspect I'm going to rely heavily on the words direct and indirect in this answer, but Essentially, what we are trying to do is to cover all bases so that we have the ability to intervene where there is a direct and explicit a necessity to do so. The indirect provision is where we are trying to find every other possible avenue that needs to be closed off to ensure that we have a system that is appropriate for the challenges that we face. So it's that it's trying to get to that level of completeness, I suppose, is how I would best describe the provisions in 86B, the changes to 86B and 86C.
Maybe give me an example of regulations which would indirectly impose restrictions.
I think the let's do it this way. An example of a direct restriction would be for us to apply a particular constraint on people leaving their houses, for example. So we'd say that's a direct consequence of the measures that we are taking. An indirect provision might be that we have to ask people to observe a particular form of behaviour which is less specific than the example I've just cited as a direct provision. So we are trying to find ways in which we can address the limitations that would be necessary to be applied that might not be ostensibly obvious as part of the original justification.
I don't know about other members. I'm still struggling, I'm afraid. I mean, I wondered if the indirect would be slightly, you know, maybe a geographical thing, that although there's a national, everybody should stay at home, but as we found with the pandemic, different parts of the country were affected differently, and to some extent, you know, maybe individual health boards or local authority education departments would then have a bit of freedom to have restrictions. Would that be covered by that, or am I...
Well, it may be that the direct indirect comparison might relate to different levels of intensity of restrictions, for example. But essentially the purpose, I think the best way to look at this is to try to not particularly look at it as specific measures within each of these categories, but to take the view that what we're trying to do is to cover all bases as part of this exercise.
Leave it at that just now. I mean, another of the new sections is 86G, which is about review of regulations. And I think we had some evidence that it was a bit vague at the moment. It says Scottish ministers must review the regulations, and then it goes into more detail about 21 days and so on, but it doesn't really say what the review would entail. And I just wonder if you think we do need to be a bit more specific, for example, the review being published, should a committee be looking at it? How do you see the review going?
Essentially, I don't view this as being particularly different from the review process that ministers undertake on a regular basis about the restrictions that we have found it necessary to put in place. So we have had the situation where ministers have reviewed every 21 days the measures that we've had in place. We have had to consider the question of whether those restrictions remain proportionate. We have had to report to Parliament about these provisions. Ministers, I and my predecessors have appeared in front of this committee on a regular basis to consider these points. So I think the possibility of you know, what we've done up until now, I think, has generally been agreed with the parliamentary authorities in relation to scrutiny. Obviously, if members wish to advance specific amendments to these provisions as to what the review might look like or what it might entail, these are issues that we can consider as part of the process of the bill. But fundamentally, I think the willingness to be open and accountable in relation to the explanation of any of these provisions lies at the heart of what the government intends to do.
Okay, thanks very much. Moving on to bankruptcy, there's been we had a fair bit of discussion around the threshold as to when someone becomes bankrupt. And I mean, £5,000, I think there's quite a lot of support for that level. Although, as we look at inflation, I mean, if inflation's 10%, you know, after a year, that £5,000 effectively is worth £4,500. After another year, it's worth £4,000. So, I mean, I don't know if that the cost of living challenges at the moment makes any difference to the government's thinking, or do you think £5,000 is the best?
We think that £5,000 is a reasonable threshold, but Mr. Mason makes an entirely fair point that we have to be careful to ensure that we have that set at an appropriate level. The cost of living challenges, we have been for most of the last, 30 years, or longer than that. Well, yeah, 30 years, we've had pretty low inflation. We're obviously dealing with a situation that is very different from that. So I think that's the best judgment that the government can come to. But obviously, I'm very happy to listen to representations from stakeholders and from members of Parliament on that question.
Okay, thanks for that. I mean, sticking with bankruptcy, the question of electronic communications, and I think, I mean, we've all moved on in that during the pandemic. But the point was made, I think, by ICAS, which I should say I'm a member of, that you know, perhaps creditors are more ready and able and willing to be operating in the electronic environment, whereas debtors might not be so much. And I think the suggestion is that maybe there should be slight, you know, we should be looking at creditors and debtors differently from that point of view. And even debtors who maybe had been able to communicate electronically, you know, might not be as their financial situation gets worse.
Mm-hmm. I think we've got to be careful here. I think, you know, Mr. Mason will recognise the benefits of that digital interaction, and I think we can see those benefits in all walks of life. And indeed, what we're trying to do with this section of the bill is take a set of pragmatic moves that will enable us to reform our public services in the light of the experience of the pandemic, where the technology enables us to do so. We've always got to be mindful of, can everyone participate in this platform? And if not, there is the need to make sure that we have alternative arrangements in place that will ensure that all parties can participate effectively in the administrative process that is involved. So there has to be, you know, whilst the digital approach suits many people, we have to make sure that it can that all individuals are able to access services accordingly.
Okay, thanks. And that kind of leads me on to the final area I'd like to look at, which is remote registration of births and deaths. I mean, we didn't have remote registration of births in the temporary legislation, but that's now being brought in. So you could maybe say something about that. But we did have some evidence that, you know, for the registrars and the local authority folk, seeing people face to face can make a real difference. And for example, you might have a mother registering the birth of a baby who is unsure whether to have the father's name on or not. And, you know, I think sometimes that's, we're talking about vulnerable people, we're talking about people that need help and guidance, and that can be better face to face. So I just wonder how you see the balance being struck between continuing in-person services and encouraging or allowing remote registration?
I think it's about... I don't think it's an either-or. I think we've got to make sure that we have arrangements in place for everybody's needs to be met. So for some people, registering remotely will be entirely convenient, much more convenient, much more straightforward, and they'll be quite happy to do so. For others, they might feel reticent and anxious about it, and an in-person appointment may suit them better. So I think it's about meeting. The best way to look at this is by providing the options that enable us to better meet the needs of all individuals, recognising that that may be different from individual to individual.
Finally, do you think there's enough safeguards in the bill that if a local authority was, kind of withdrawing in-person service, that they would still have to provide it to some extent?
Yes, I think that is the case, but that may well be a point that members wish to come back to provide some degree of further legislative constraint if that's felt not to be sufficiently strong.
Thanks very much.
Thank you. Can we move to Brian Whittle, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and to the panel, and I'll hope you're on the mend, Mr Swinney. I think you probably recognise that we don't necessarily agree in some of this, and I just want to go back to the word proportionality, which is the bit that exercises me on this one. And as you said, it's ministers who will decide what proportionality is. You would recognise there is a level of subjectiveness to that, and in terms of safeguard and balances, I just feel, you know, that it's Parliament scrutiny that is the main safeguard in these kind of decisions. And I don't know if you'd recognise that by passing this bill, you basically bypass that safeguard, that scrutiny.
We certainly don't bypass Parliament, not in any shape or form. This legislation will only come into effect if Parliament approves it. So that's the first bit of parliamentary scrutiny. Parliament has got to agree to put in place whatever proposals emerge out of this bill. That's the first layer of parliamentary scrutiny. The second is that Parliament makes provision for the exercise of the affirmative and the made affirmative process of regulation. So Parliament has, for some time, directed that regulations of that nature may be taken forward. These are two other levels of parliamentary scrutiny. The affirmative requires an order to be placed before Parliament for it to be discussed and considered, and for Parliament to vote on it before it can be brought into effect. The made affirmative procedure allows ministers to bring that into effect, but it can only remain in effect if it is consented to by Parliament. Now, I think, primary legislation and then regulation making power fully satisfies parliamentary scrutiny. I think, as I signalled in my answers to Mr Fraser, I am open to seeing whether there are any further additional safeguards that could address the type of concerns that Mr Whittle is putting to me, because I think there must be agreement that we need to have a statute book that is fit for purpose, because Mr Whittle and his colleagues supported the legislation that was put forward by the two coronavirus bills in 2020. They obviously saw the need for there to be legislation to act in this respect. So there's no disputing the fact that that's necessary. The point of dispute is the mechanism for going about it. And if there is some progress we can make in that respect, as I indicated in my earlier answers, I'm very happy to engage on that point.
Thank you, Mr. Spinner. That's very helpful. I think contrary to perhaps what my colleague, Mr. Rowley, said, that the driving force here is actually to make sure that we are prepared should this ever happen again. I think it's preparedness that I want to focus on here. I think, as you've said, you didn't have the, you didn't feel you had the appropriate legislation in March 2020 when it came before Parliament the first time. But my view, Mr. Swinney, is that the Scottish Government should be focusing on the preparedness for sort of future health emergencies. And for an example, I would say, if you remember the Silver Swan Initiative, which was run to test preparedness for such eventualities as COVID, and the recommendations that made, we discovered had actually been allowed to lapse. And having had that experience, would it not be more relevant to ensure those recommendations and any further updated recommendations following the pandemic were adhered to? Is that not the direction of travel really we should be going in? Because I think it was, for me, it was that lack of preparedness that caused the main issues at the start.
Well, it's both that have got to be proceeded with. We can do nothing to update the statute book, and then we'll find ourselves, if we have another pandemic, having to rush through parliamentary legislation. And heaven forfend, Mr. Whittle might be one of the people saying this is ridiculous, this has all been rushed through in a few days. I don't rule that out as a possibility. And then there's the logistical preparation for pandemics, and these are all issues that will be looked at by the public inquiry. It's one of the elements that Lady Poole will look at about the preparedness for a pandemic. And the government is obviously reviewing the preparations that we have in place for a whole range of emergency arrangements. We regularly review the potential threats that we face consider the degree to which we are equipped for those threats, and we will continue to do that for the foreseeable future.
If I could just, I want to push that a little bit, because again, I'm looking back, Mr. Swinney, as a response and what would the appropriate response be. And I would put it to you that we actually did see the pandemic coming. We watched it coming from China, moving across the world, and it was actually the fact that we did not prepare properly, we didn't respond quickly enough, and surely that experience would change the way in which we are prepared and the measures that we put in place, and it wouldn't actually be emergency legislation that would make the big change and the big change to outcomes.
I think the first emergence of the COVID virus from China was in the latter days of 2019. And it started having its effect in Scotland late February, early March, around about that period. So, I think there's a limited window that was available for us to put in place the arrangements that Mr. Whittle might have envisaged. I think for my part, I think one of the most critical elements, looking back, and which should be the foundation of our response, is around testing infrastructure. I think testing infrastructure is absolutely critical to all that we are doing in this respect. And there may be an argument, there is an argument, and I subscribe to that argument, that we should have in place effective testing arrangements to enable us to be able to ratchet that up to a much greater level than has been the case, than was the case back in the early part of 2020. So yes, there are practical preparations that we can and should be making, but we were only able to handle the pandemic because we were able to exercise legislative control of the measures that we put forward, and that was the government recognising the scale of the threat and putting them in place as quickly as we possibly could do.
Well, I think you know, my argument would be, Mr. Swinney, that it took us too long. That's not a criticism of any, or your government or any government in particular. I think it did take us too long to respond to that, and I think, and we're, as you know, Mr. Swinney, we're now reviewing that response, and there'll be a report on that. And I would suggest to you that perhaps that is the time, maybe, that we should be considering how and if we should change the statute book.
I think there'll be a lot of consideration of the pandemic. Lady Poole's inquiry will do that significantly, but obviously we'll have to wait some time before we get the conclusions of that. The government has, you know, I recognise that there are differences of opinion in this respect, but you know, from my perspective, the government could be pressed to learn the lessons of the pandemic, make sure we've got our house in order, and I think that's essentially what the government has done. We've looked at our legislation, we've looked at the fact that there are gaps, and we've brought forward a bill which aims to address those in relation to the public health measures. And obviously, it's a possibility that at some stage in the future, further legislative change can be made, but that will be for the government, for Parliament to consider in due course.
Jim Fairley, please.
Thank you very much, Convener. Thank you very much, Convener. And I wish you well in your recovery, Mr. Swinney. It's clearly been a tough morning for you. I'm very quickly going to ask you a couple of quick questions. Why were the powers not included in the Public Health Scotland Bill when England and Wales legislation was updated to include them in 2008?
I'm not quite following Mr. Fairley's question.
Sorry, I've gone right back to the very first questions that you were asked by the convener. It says that the powers of Public Health Scotland Bill wasn't updated in 2008 when England and Wales already had those powers.
I can't honestly answer that question as to what was in the minds of ministers at that particular time. I'd have to go and have a look at past papers to consider whether these issues had been looked at, and what was the purpose of the public health legislation of that time. I suspect the public health legislation in 2008 was reviewed to update specific issues about localised incidents, and didn't have the scope to look at a population-wide challenge of the nature that we have faced. That would be my first response, but I will consider that further, and if there is any more information I think I can share with the committee, I'll write to the convener accordingly.
But it would kind of emphasise the point that we actually need to update our statute book.
It would, certainly, because there is no doubt in my mind the fact that we had to make such significant legislative change in extremis twice in the spring of 2020 indicates to me that our statute book is not up to date.
Okay, thank you. And very quickly, should the process for applying special restrictions and any subsequent appeals process be on the face of the bill? Now, I get that you've accepted the fact that you're happy to look at stuff, the issues that Mr. Fraser raised with you. Should the process for applying those restrictions be on the face of the bill?
I would contend that we have adequate measures in the legislation that set out how that can be undertaken. I think the question that Parliament needs to consider is, are those powers appropriate and can they be exercised in a proportionate and appropriate fashion? And so all those factors need to be considered, but I think that is achieved by the terms of the bill, but obviously if there are particular suggestions to be made by the committee or by members, then I will of course engage on those questions.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move on to mental health and the named person. We took evidence on that. And we are running short of time, so I'm just going to very quickly go through the points that have been raised. Is how should people be informed about the role and responsibilities of being a named person, if additional guidance on the role and responsibilities of being a named person is needed, and whether a nominee should be required to declare that they understand the role and rights and responsibilities of being a named person?
I think it is important that that is fully and properly understood. When it comes to understanding the role of a named person, there is a code of practice, a statutory code of practice, which does this. It states that it would be best for the mental health officer or any other practitioner discussing this with the nominee to ensure they are provided with information about the role of a named person in a form which is helpful to them. It would be best practice to provide information to the nominee about their rights and the patient's rights. The process of checking understanding is separate to the requirement for the nominated person's a consent to be witnessed, and so there are a number of protections in place to ensure that that concept and that role can be properly explained to individuals and understood by individuals.
Can I very quickly move on to moratorium on diligence? The bill at stage one doesn't contain provision in relation to the moratorium. However, the Scottish Government has stated that amendments in this subject may be brought forward in stage two. Does the Scottish Government intend to bring forward any amendments to the moratorium on diligence at stage two? And if so, has the Government reached a view on how long the moratorium should last?
We are likely to bring forward an amendment to the moratorium at stage two. In terms of the timescale, there's differing views on what the appropriate moratorium period should be on a permanent basis. So we're taking time to consider what that timescale should be. During the pandemic, there was a temporary period of 6 months put in place. In England, Wales, the period is 60 days. So I think there's a range of different views. So we're in the process of just essentially weighing up those different views and setting out that provision, which will take the form of a stage two, is likely to take the form of a stage two amendment.
Okay. We also had evidence in digital and remote service delivery. We heard from local authority witnesses that online delivery of services that had to happen at the speed of the beginning of the pandemic. Mary Miller at Glasgow City Council accepted there was a lot could be done to reconfigure those services and make them more accessible. However, significant work needs to be done to ensure remote services developed at speed during the pandemic meet the needs of the users. But will the Scottish Government be able to make funding available to support this?
There's two aspects to this question. One is about the adaptability of public services and for their ability to be used within the digital environment. And I think great improvements have been made, but I think there's a way to go. I think we're still, ministers have been very clear that we think that we are too far behind the private sector on developments here. You know, we can, the availability of private sector provision is significantly ahead of public sector provision. So that's one priority. The second is about making sure that we overcome the digital divide so that people are actually able to gain access to or to have the ability to use technology to gain access to public services. And the Connected Communities Initiative is now making very significant progress in this respect, and I welcome the steps that have been made. So that would be through those two channels. Different funding from the Scottish Government would be available to address these questions.
Okay. Provisions Part 3 of the Bill mainly enable public service providers to offer remote services rather than require them to. Local authority witness highlighted the success of remote services delivered during the pandemic, the potential for resource savings.
Will the Scottish Government consider amending the bill to include a requirement to continue to offer in-person services?
I think I certainly will consider that point, because I think it's been quite interesting just dealing with constituency caseload around about the recent census, where there has been, for the first time, the census has been undertaken digitally, predominantly digitally, and some constituents of mine have been concerned about not being able to do that to get paper copies. So I think what it says to me is that we have to be constantly mindful of the importance of ensuring that we have both options available to individuals. And if we and if there aren't adequate safeguards in the bill, then we should be prepared to consider those.
There was also specific concern about the option to provide remote services, what that might mean for licensed applicants. Currently, the bill gives licensing bodies complete discretion as to how a hearing is held. Where a meeting was held remotely, emergency legislation gave applicants and objectors the right to decide how they want to participate. But the bill will give licensing bodies complete discretion as to the format of licensing hearings. Should it be amended to give those entitled to participate in the hearings more of a say? Because I have to say, doing it remotely is a lot harder when you're trying to get your point across if you're in dispute.
Well, I'm certainly happy to consider that. The thrust of the legislation is to try to ensure that we have an appropriate way in which we can, make the process more efficient, try to minimise disruption. I think I've been quite struck, even in my own work over the course of the pandemic, my constituency work, how the use of technology has significantly enhanced the way in which I can conveniently engage with constituents. So instead of people having to drive from Rannoch Station to Blairgowrie to see me, because I happened to be in Blairgowrie that day, a Zoom call can save them a round trip of about 4 hours to come and see their Member of Parliament. So I think that, to my shame, that had never dawned on me until the pandemic. So I think there's a desire in this section of the bill to try to secure the opportunities for greater efficiency and effectiveness arising out of our experience in the pandemic. And I think we should be open to do that, but not in the way that makes the process disadvantageous to individuals. And the point that Mr. Fairley makes to me is that that approach may be disadvantageous to a licensing applicant.
That would be my point, is that absolutely get that we can make things far more streamlined and all the rest of it, but there will be times when people will want to have a sit-down conversation in a face-to-face environment, and I think that's something that we should possibly consider. Thank you.
I think there's also an important point to add to that, Convener, is that it is the responsibility of licensing boards and licensing authorities to ensure that virtual meetings and hearings are conducted in a manner that meets the accessibility and engagement requirements of attendees. So the onus is on the body to make sure they're doing it in a way that can meet the needs of the licensing application. But if there is a need for us to perhaps make that more explicit, then I'm happy to consider it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Deputy First Minister, I do have just a few more questions that I need to ask. Many of the powers in 2008 Act require an application to the Sheriff Court in order to be applied. However, the bill does not appear to stipulate a specific process when applying the special restrictions and requirements, including the requirement for example, a person to submit a medical examination. In the absence of the requirement to obtain a sheriff's order, what will the process be when seeking to apply the special restrictions and requirements, and how will the human rights of the individual be adequately safeguarded?
The first point is that there can be no debate or questioning about the protection of the human rights of applicants. So that must underpin the process that is put in place. What we have to then satisfy ourselves is that we have in place arrangements that will enable individuals to be able to engage with public authorities in a way that that does exactly that, that they can achieve their proper engagement in the process and their rights can be assured in the process. The bill is designed to give an appropriate specification on that point. If there are issues about whether or not sufficient specification has been given, then obviously I'm very happy to consider that as part of the bill process.
Thank you very much for that response. And just moving on to lastly, monitoring public health risks. Clause 1 also inserts a new Section 86H into the Public Health Act, Scotland Act 200, that will allow Scottish ministers to confer functions on bodies and persons' powers to monitor public health risks. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to explain how he expects these powers to be used going forward? And will these provisions support ongoing preparedness for future public health threats? And if so, what types of health threats could be detected by these measures?
I think there's a difference here, Convener. The measures to which you refer are measures within the bill during the course of a pandemic. So this is a power which would enable ministers through regulations to put particular monitoring responsibilities on public authorities. In terms of the obligation for preparedness, that is something that public authorities will be taking forward as part of their routine work under existing statutory arrangements to ensure that we are prepared for all resilience challenges that we face. And these are issues that we revisit on a regular basis through the Scottish Resilience Partnership, and which we also take forward as part of the wider work that we undertake with public authorities to ensure their preparedness for such eventualities.
Thank you very much. And that concludes our consideration of this agenda item. And I'd like to thank the Deputy First Minister and his officials for their evidence today. If we move on to agenda item number 2, which is the ministerial statement on COVID-19, the committee will take evidence from the Scottish Government on the latest ministerial statement on COVID-19. And I welcome back to the meeting Deputy First Minister and Professor Jason Leach. Thank you for your attendance this morning. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any remarks before we move on to questions?
If I could make some opening remarks, Convener, I'm grateful to the committee for the opportunity to discuss a number of matters, including updates to Parliament on COVID-19. As set out by the First Minister yesterday, we are currently experiencing high numbers of cases in Scotland, and this reflects the impact of the BA2 variant, which we know to be even more infectious than the original Omicron variant. Alongside infection levels, the high number of people in hospital with COVID, even if they were admitted for another condition, is putting the NHS under severe strain. There are, however, some grounds for optimism that the latest wave of the pandemic may now have peaked, and we will continue to assess the data closely to see whether these early signs are indeed indicative of a sustained fall in cases. Despite the infectiousness of the BA2 variant, vaccination continues to provide good protection against serious illness, and our programme of booster jabs for certain groups is now underway. The programme started 3 weeks ago in older people's care homes, and from last week appointments have been offered to everyone aged 75 and over. And people with suppressed immune systems will have appointments scheduled during spring and summer. In line with JCVI advice, vaccination of the wider 5 to 11-year-old age group started on the 19th of March and will continue over coming weeks. Vaccination remains the most important thing any of us can do to protect ourselves and others, and the Scottish Government has continued to ensure that as many people as possible are vaccinated. As mentioned, our NHS is facing very significant pressure, and we must be attentive to the needs of the NHS in tackling the virus. For the period up until Easter, we are continuing to ask everyone to take a lateral flow test twice a week and to take a test daily for 7 days if you are in close contact of a positive case, and to take a test before visiting someone who is vulnerable. If you have symptoms, you should get a PCR test, and if you test positive, you should isolate and follow advice from Test and Protect. Using the approach set out in our revised strategic framework and based on clinical advice, our assessment is that the virus continues to present a medium threat, although we remain optimistic that it will move to being a low threat during the summer, the spring and summer. We have largely moved away from using legally imposed protective measures to control the virus, instead relying on vaccines, treatments and sensible public health behaviours and adaptations. When most legal requirements were lifted earlier in March, we retained in law the requirement to wear face coverings on public transport and in certain indoor settings. Cabinet have now agreed to convert the legal requirement to guidance in a phased approach. From the 4th of April, it will no longer be a legal requirement to wear a face covering in places of worship or while attending a marriage ceremony, a civil partnership registration or a funeral service or commemorative event. From the 18th of April, the wider legal requirement applying to shops, certain other indoor settings and public transport will be converted to guidance. Through guidance, we will continue to encourage the wearing of face coverings where appropriate. I'm very happy to answer questions from the committee.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister, and I'll turn to questions. If I could ask the first question, if I may. With the removal of masks later this month, there's a lot of people, especially the clinically vulnerable, that are quite anxious regarding this as COVID is still prevalent. Guidance was published by the Scottish Government in January this year regarding the Distance Aware Scheme. How can the Scottish Government raise more awareness of this scheme to protect our most vulnerable as we remove masks?
I think it is important that we continue to take actions to support those who are very vulnerable. I understand why some people want to see the removal of face coverings, but I have to say that my own humble opinion is the most inconvenient thing that we've ever been asked to do as citizens, but it's something that can be done to help and to protect those who are much more vulnerable within our society. So the government will certainly be encouraging people to continue to voluntarily wear face coverings to do so in appropriate locations. In relation to the Distance Aware Scheme, the government has spent significant amounts of time in promoting the Distance Aware Scheme. I'm certain it needs to be continued to be promoted, and we will do so over the course of the forthcoming period to make sure there is as wide awareness as possible about the merits of this scheme, because it's so critical in providing reassurance and understanding to members of the public.
Thank you for that response. Can I move to members, please? And Murdo Fraser, please.
Thank you, Convener. I've got just a couple of very particular constituency issues I'd like to raise, Deputy First Minister. Firstly, I've had a number of constituents contact me who are parents of children in school in fifth year who presently are studying for hires in a few weeks' time. Firstly, they're looking for an assurance there's no prospect of the current exam diet being cancelled, because we do know that there are some schools with large staff absences. But also those wondering that should pupils contract COVID and not be able to sit the higher exams on the day required, what other arrangements will be in place for them? So I wonder if you can help with that.
Yeah. On the first question, there is the exam diet will go ahead, and that's the approach that's been taken. On a situation where a young person is unable to sit an exam because of COVID, then obviously there are routine arrangements in place to address the implications of that on a pupil-by-pupil basis, and no pupil will be disadvantaged by those arrangements, and obviously it will be the subject of engaging with individual schools to make sure the arrangements can be put in place to support young people who might find themselves in that situation. But SQA will work with individual schools to ensure that no pupil is disadvantaged in that respect.
And my second question on an entirely separate matter about vaccinations. We currently have, I think, over 75s who are being called for their second booster. So I've been contacted by someone living in the Rannoch area, which you'll know well, where at the present residents are being directed to travel to Pitlochry to the vaccination centre, which is quite a substantial round trip and very difficult for people who rely upon public transport. And the question was whether or not rural GP practices could be authorised to deliver vaccines for those who have transport difficulties. Is that something the Scottish Government is looking at?
The difficulty here is actually not about the putting in place of travel arrangements. The difficulty here is not solved by putting in place transport arrangements. The difficulty is caused by, and Professor Leach may contradict me on this, but I don't think I'm wrong here, is because it's a Pfizer dose that is being administered. And the Pfizer dose comes in a larger block than the other vaccines, and therefore it cannot be broken down to be able to be undertaken in GP practices. And so that's why individuals may have to go to a centre such as Pitlochry, which I appreciate is a distance for people in the Rannoch area. Dealt with constituency concerns about this on my own behalf in this respect, but it's because of the nature of the virus. Professor Leach might want to add to what I've said there.
Hey, morning, everybody. I think that's the quietest I've been at committee for an hour and a quarter. The Deputy First Minister is absolutely right. Each vaccine comes slightly differently packaged. Each has slightly different rules about freezing and cold storage and all of those things. There are some GP practices administering COVID vaccine. It's a local decision made by local vaccine coordinators and whatever is available in that area. But it is much more efficient in terms of wastage and in terms of efficiency of delivery if you can do it certainly in medium-sized units, never mind the larger units like the Hydro and the Exhibition Centre in Edinburgh. But it is not impossible for some GPs to be able to give vaccines. That's a workforce challenge, but also an equipment and vaccine challenge.
Thank you.
Thank you, Alex. Yeah. Could I ask, the last time I think, Mr. Swinney, you were at this committee, asked about the lateral flow tests and costs, and I think we got mixed up between what I was asking and what you said, because you said that they would continue to be free, but I think you meant up until the point where they stopped being given out, which is sometime in mid-April. And I know that, well, there's about three points to this. Firstly, in terms of health and social care settings, will the lateral flow test continue to be available? The EIS are campaigning to keep lateral flow tests in school for all staff, and they're making an argument as to why that is important. And if you look at just now, I mean, some schools are having to send year groups home. Some schools have got loads of kids sitting in assembly rooms half a day. So there is still a major problem in schools in terms of COVID and particularly staffing. So how would you respond be to the EIS request that staff in schools continue to get lateral flow tests, access to them free? And thirdly, what would your answer be in terms of the cost of living crisis and the fact that for many people, your ministers are already talking about people choosing between heating and eating. So lateral flow tests is probably, buying them is probably going to fall further down that list. Are you relaxed enough? I know you say that you feel that you're optimistic that things, the spread in the virus will be lower into the spring and summer. But what about these groups in particular?
Yeah, I think if I address the last point first, because it actually is a gateway into the whole question. I ordinarily, all things being equal, I would like us to be maintaining a pretty significant level of testing on lateral flow device testing. I think it would be beneficial. I think it gives a lot of intelligence and assurance. But I've also got to look at the hard financial realities in the wake of the decision of the United Kingdom government. Because of the decision of the UK government in relation to what they were prepared to fund, that has a direct effect on the consequential funding available to the Scottish government, which limits it, which makes it difficult for us to sustain more than the larger proposition that we are already putting in place. In relation to health and social care staff, there will still be a testing environment in place for health and social care staff, and it will continue to be free. In relation to the situation of school staff, I'm obviously aware of the EIS campaigns, very familiar with the strength of opinion within the EIS and within school staff about the importance of testing arrangements being in place. We obviously are maintaining those for a longer period than is the case in other parts of the United Kingdom. But unfortunately, there are limitations placed on us by the decisions the UK government has taken.
Okay. And what about the whole question of the cost of living crisis and the fact that, I mean, if I want to go and get a test, I can afford it, but for many people on lower incomes, that's just not going to be part of their budget.
Yes, and I'm very concerned about that, because I think it gets to the heart of the wider challenges that we will face around the cost of living within our society, and why, you know, the Scottish Government will do everything we possibly can do to try to maximise the support for and the resilience of people who face challenges and hardship in our society. But it is a significant challenge to be able to try to do all of these different measures as part of the within the financial constraints in which we operate.
On that point, people in terms of lower income, in terms of vaccination take up. The data that I have looked at shows that there has been a stark reduction once we hit the 40 under 40 age group. A situation not unique to Scotland, I would have to say, but across the UK. But there is definitely a stark reduction in take up of the third dose. And then likewise, if I look at the socio-economic status, there's no doubt The ONS have looked at data in relation to vaccine uptake, free school meals. Now, this is England, but there's no reason why the same would not apply in Scotland. And there is a clear correlation between lower socioeconomic status, deprivation, poverty, and uptake of vaccine, particularly as we've got to reach the third dose. Do you find that to be the case, and is there a need for the Scottish Government to consider further action in terms of trying to encourage vaccine uptake, particularly amongst those areas and groups where it's lowest?
I think given the centrality of vaccine as the most effective protection against the virus, I think, you know, we are constantly looking at ways in which we can intensify the focus on vaccine uptake. The vaccine programme as a whole has been phenomenally successful in reaching high levels of uptake, but that very strong position at a global, national level masks the position at in some particular categories and groups and geographical areas, which is not as strong. So we are constantly looking for practical ways in which we can try to ensure the vaccine take-up is more accessible by the public campaigns that we put out, by the availability of venues that are accessible and convenient. If I look at my own locality, I think NHS Tayside has gone to considerable lengths to try to find locations and areas where they could try to boost vaccine uptake into some of the areas that Mr. Rowley puts to me, with some success, but it needs to be continuously pursued to ensure that we can maximise the uptake of the vaccine, because it is the biggest protection that individuals can have.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Jim Fairley, would you like to come in?
Thank you, Convener. Mr. Swinney, hopefully you'll get a wee rest on this question, because I'm really targeting this one to Jason Leach. We spoke before about a constituent of mine who is very concerned about getting the vaccine. She's going through various medical issues through cancer. She had an adverse reaction to a flu jag, and she's very, very concerned about getting any form of vaccine to do with coronavirus. There are still venues that will require a vaccine passport, which she will obviously not be able to get. And her question that she puts to me is, there is a panel of four people who decide what the exemption should be, but she will not be allowed to give her own voice to the issue that she has. Is that the case? Is that correct, that there's a panel of four people who make that decision? What are the criteria for not getting the vaccine? And is there anything that can be done to allow her to have her voice heard to put her point across?
Thank you, Mr. Fairley. Firstly, my advice is to get the vaccine and to go to a vaccination centre and have that conversation with a senior member of the vaccination team. It may not be the first person you meet in the vaccination team. It may be escalated up through the process, and have a very, very serious conversation and make sure that is absolutely the decision you want to make, and understand the implications of doing it, but also deeply understand the implications of not doing it. Never mind the fact you won't be able to go to a London theatre probably for a little while, but the implications of catching the disease, particularly if you are immunocompromised because of cancer care. That strikes me, the limited knowledge I have of this case, that strikes me as a much higher risk than the vaccine. So that's point number one. Go and talk about getting the vaccine. Point number two is the exemptions are fairly limited for a very good reason, because there are very few diseases or conditions that contradict getting the vaccine, simply because the vaccine is safe, and it is safe in almost everybody. So this constituent, I imagine, doesn't fit into one of those categories. They can, of course, ask, they can make that case. I have no knowledge that there is four people in a quiet room somewhere making individual decisions about people's lives. It's not the system I'm familiar with. What we've done is we've categorised the highest risk individuals for a vaccine. So that would be people who have absolute confirmed allergy to the constituents in the vaccine. We're not going to vaccinate them. End of life care people who unfortunately have had very, very bad news, and therefore the vaccine is inappropriate for those individuals. Some people with some immunosuppression diseases in which the vaccine is contraindicated, but it's a very small group. I'm afraid exemption is not something you can just request and get. But if you want to send those details in, we will absolutely get the individuals involved to look at it and make sure that all that's been done is appropriate. I would go back to my initial point. Vaccination is safer than COVID.
Okay, thank you very much. The final point I'm going to make, and this is one that has been raised with me again and again by the same constituent, is that apparently Professor Linda Bald had made a statement somewhere in the media or on the television that if you have an adverse reaction to the flu jab, do not get the COVID jab. Now, I don't know if that's verified or not, but it's a position that keeps getting put back to me. Is that correct?
It's not blanket correct. Look, Linda may certainly have said that in some context with a specific question. Linda Bald's advice, I imagine, would be the same as mine. Go and discuss your case with a senior vaccinator who understand both your challenge, of course, we're not forcing anybody, but also the disease, COVID, and the risk or otherwise of having that vaccination. And an allergic adverse reaction to flu vaccine is very different from a side effect to the flu vaccine. So we'd need to understand exactly what happened and exactly which vaccine it was, and then we can make some choices about which vaccine to suggest, if any, for COVID.
That's good. Thank you very much.
Can I move to Brian Whittle, please?
Thank you, convener. If I could, I just want to go back to education, if I could, and, you know, I've vested interest in this, given one of my daughters is a teacher and one of my other daughters is a pupil who transitioned from primary seven and is now in second year. So through the whole COVID experience has missed significant classroom time. And I think despite the greatest efforts of teachers, the online learning will not replace learning face-to-face for many. So I just wanted to ask the Deputy First Minister how the Scottish Government propose to fill that sort of gap in learning.
The first thing I'd say is that I have listened, obviously, during my time as Education Secretary to a very significant number of experienced educators who were very keen to ensure that we did not disparage online learning, because there is a really strong place for online and digital learning for young people within our education system. It broadens choice, it deepens the opportunities for understanding and appreciation of subjects. And many educationalists have been trying to make advances in digital learning for some considerable time. So I think it's a really important asset for us. And ironically, during the pandemic, by merits of the involvement of teachers around the country, the measures such as the eSchool and the West of Scotland Learning Partnership, there is now a very, very strong digital learning proposition available to young people in Scotland that they can dip into in their own time. And then also a whole range of different examples of digital learning that are taken forward by individual schools. So I think that's something that we should really celebrate. The second point is in relation to the impact of the pandemic on the learning of young people, and individual schools are concentrating very closely on making sure that the needs of young people are met through the education system, that they can secure the necessary engagement in their learning, and indeed a whole variety of different approaches have been taken to make sure that is the case. There will obviously be an impact on learning as a consequence of the pandemic. It's an inevitability of the disruption to the education system, but I think teachers are working very hard to make sure that is minimised to young people where it can possibly be minimised.
Thank you, Mr. Swinney. I didn't say all, I said many, and I think one of the issues that has been raised is there are those where the inequality, if you like, in learning, the pandemic has deepened that, and there are sections of society and sections of our pupils, perhaps, that there should be a focus on. So, but thank you. Your response is helpful. If I could just one other point that's been raised with me is that we know, if I could transition into health. We know that roughly half of COVID cases in hospital are with patients who come in for another condition, and the worry what's been raised with me is a worry that perhaps there's still this reluctance to seek medical help because of concern around contracting COVID in hospitals. So how is the Scottish Government managing to, or what are they doing to make sure that that hesitation is overcome and get people to seek critical medical help as soon as it's required, because to not do so will in itself cause a strain in NHS with later presentations?
I think I'll invite Professor Leach to add to my remarks, but this is a very important issue, that people present for healthcare in the appropriate context and at the appropriate time. For some people, that will be to present very early when they have emerging symptoms of a potentially more acute and challenging condition. So I think throughout the pandemic, we have maintained cancer care, And we've maintained a message that the health service remained open for people should they require it. I do accept, however, that that doesn't fully address the reluctance that Mr. Whittle puts to me, because I think people are nervous about going to hospital because of the risk of attracting COVID. And fundamentally, this is this can only be addressed by the forum in which we deliver healthcare, about making sure that we meet the needs of individuals in their own, as much as we possibly can do within their own communities. And some of the measures, such as hospital at home, are designed to ensure that we provide that care literally as close to home as we possibly can do for individuals. But Professor Leach might want to add to what I've said there.
It is a crucial issue, Mr. Whittle, as we've talked before. We need to be slightly careful. There are three categories of positive patients in hospital. There are those who are in hospital principally because they are suffering from COVID. There are some who are in with other conditions who brought COVID in with them. So on admission, they were tested and they were positive, but they've had a stroke or a heart attack or a broken leg. And COVID will make their recovery harder, almost universally. And then there's a third small group who catch COVID in hospital from other staff members or patients who have COVID in the environment. That is a small group. And you shouldn't be scared to go to healthcare because you might catch COVID. That is not a reason not to go. The other thing is, it is relatively unusual that hospital would be your first port of call with signs or symptoms of disease. Of course, there are some things when that's appropriate, if you're in emergency, if you're taken by ambulance. But actually, the health service doesn't work like that. The health service works with you going to your pharmacy or your dentist or your GP or NHS Inform or NHS 24. Those systems remain open. They remain accessible. Of course, there are challenges in some places and on some days and in some hours. Of course, there are. But that's the way into the health service with whatever it is that's troubling. And then hospitals will become part of your care if and when required.
Thank you. John Mason, would you like to come in?
Thanks, convener. And first of all, can I welcome the fact that we do not have to wear masks in churches and other places of worship as of Monday? I think that will be very welcome. And I think the idea of gradually reducing the requirement for masks is a sensible one. I really just have one question, and it's following on from what Professor Leach just said about the three categories. So we've got these 2,300 people in hospital with COVID, who, and they span the three categories, as I understand it. So can we break down between these three categories, you know, how many are in hospital because of COVID, how many are in hospital, would have been in hospital anyway, but they've got COVID as well. Is that possible? I don't mind who answers.
Yeah, I was waiting for my microphone. Sorry, it's partly possible. So we know in most developed countries at this point in their Omicron wave, I know that's not a particularly satisfactory piece of analysis, it's about 50-50, 60-40, 40-60, but let's, for the sake of argument, say it's about half and half. Half have got serious problems with COVID and have been admitted for COVID. The other half, in approximate terms, are worse because of COVID, but as you suggest, would probably have been in hospital pre-pandemic with a stroke, a heart attack or something else. As I've said many times in this committee, I wish healthcare were as binary as that. It, of course, isn't. Most people don't end up in hospital with one thing. They end up in hospital with delirium, dementia, a hip replacement and COVID. It's not as neat as one or the other. There are a small number, I don't have it to hand, of healthcare acquired infections of COVID, but it's nothing like half or 40% of those big numbers. So the first two categories occupy the vast majority, and then there are a small number of people who you can never be absolutely sure, but would appear, because they've been in hospital for a prolonged period, have caught COVID during their hospital stay. Again, making their recovery usually more complicated, because it makes healing more difficult, it makes recovery more difficult in pretty much every disease we have.
Very helpful. Thanks very much.
Thank you. I'm just going to bring in Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if I could just go back to the question of education and just ask for some clarification on an issue that's been discussed over the last day. Following the announcement yesterday about lifting the requirement for wearing face masks from the 18th of April, there seems to be some confusion as to what the situation will apply in schools where face masks are still being worn in communal areas. Yesterday, a Scottish Government spokesman said that face coverings would still be required in communal areas for staff and secondary pupils after the 18th of April, but that seems to have been reined back on this morning. Deputy First Minister, can you just clarify exactly what the position is now?
The position I understand is that masks will not be required in communal areas as an obligation from the 18th of April, but that wearing them will be recommended as something that would be beneficial for maintaining some protection in place.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item, and I'd like to thank the Deputy First Minister for your attendance today, despite being ill, and we wish you a very speedy recovery. And also like to thank all the supporting officials for their attendance this morning. The committee's next meeting will be on the 21st of April, when we will consider our Stage 1 report on the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill. In private, that concludes the public part of our meeting this morning. I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave. Thank you.